Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church on this beautiful Lord's Day. God's gracious to us and gave us a day that we can worship Him in. It's beautiful weather, and we appreciate your presence here in the auditorium. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour. That's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We hope during the hour coming up, we can be an inspiration to everyone. Appreciate you in the radio listening audience tuning in. If you call someone, have them to tune in. We'd appreciate it. And we welcome you here in the auditorium. We welcome our visitors with us today. May the Lord bless you. Take your Bible today and turn to Genesis chapter 3 for the reading of God's Word. The message today and the music, of course, the singing will be on tape number 325. Tape number 325. If you'd like to have the tape, you can write in and request it. Say, Preach Edward, send me tape number 325. I'm speaking on the subject, Satan's three-lane avenue of temptation. And you can write in and request it by my sermon title or by number. We send the tape out for a gift of $3. The $3 is used to help defray our radio expense. And we work us together in getting out the gospel. May God bless you as you have a part in this ministry. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. Turn to Genesis chapter 3. There was a little boy that seemed to be getting a lot of whippings. He called them beatings, beaten by his mother, beaten by his daddy, beaten by his school teacher, beaten by his big brother, beaten by some of his playmates, and he got disgusted. He said, I'm going into Atlanta and join the Atlanta Braves. They don't ever beat anybody. So he wanted to be sure that his beating is over whenever he joined that outfit. All right, Genesis chapter 3. And beginning with verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, but God does know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Satan's three-lane avenue of temptation. That's a key verse in 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. I want to pass on to you. Listen to it, or either turn there and follow me in the scriptures. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. So he gives us a three-way avenue of temptation here and said that's all that's in the world. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Every temptation that comes your way usually comes down one of these three avenues. Now I know we're living in a day when there's much today to tempt people. There's never been a time when there's so much to tempt people as in this hour in which we live. We know our conveniences and things we enjoy, like the TV and various other things and sports and whatnot we have in the world today, and entertainments that's going on, and automobiles and the way we dress and all of that. The devil today is really knocking a home run. Now, the reason is because he knows his time is short. And many of these things we can use for good. Satan seems to take them many times and use them for evil. Back when I was a boy growing up, we didn't face some of the things that our young people face today. Although the devil still travels down the three avenues, but seems like it's kind of blossomed out some of the temptations that's way before people today. You know the real problems we're having with drugs today out in California, where they're trying to straighten out some youth out there because of the gangs. They have formed gangs and they're killing each other, killed some 85 in the past few months. Gangs killing each other, and they're trying to do something about it. Countries yonder in the South America and Central America are growing all kind of dope and cocaine and stuff and send it to America. And when our nation tries to do something about the kingpin, the leader of that outfit, then they rise up and take a stand against America. And it's pitiful. We try to curb the dope situation in the land today. And yet it seems to be getting worse all the time. And then the crime wave yonder in Cyprus, unless the plane has been moved out, how those hijackers have hijacked that plane and killed a poor innocent man and threw him out. And you see it on TV how they threw him out the door and he hit the ground and they came and took his body. See, we're soft on crime today. We don't do what God said do in the book. Now, if they could take those people that hijacked that plane, what they ought to do is string them up out there and shoot them immediately. They ought to dispose of them immediately, but instead of doing that, they will put them in prison and feed them and take care of them and send them to prison. And later on, another gang will hijack a plane to try to get them out of prison. See, we don't have any real common sense today, and our criminal judicial system today is rotten to the core. The liberals have wrecked this nation, and the world's been wrecked by the liberals today, and by defying and going contrary to the Word of God. You have young jackleg lawyers running around today. Whenever you're going to try somebody that deserves a death penalty and ought to be put to death, they want to run around and try to outlaw the death penalty. And see, such stuff is there. And then jackleg lawyers will travel to prisons and talk to prisoners, then run and talk to some stooges to get them to overturn the death penalty, and things of that type is filling our land with crime and criminals today. And we're not safe anymore in our homes, on the streets, in our cities. And some of these jackleg lawyers trying to make a name for themselves, they care nothing about the suffering of the victims or the suffering of the victim's family, or how much it's going to cost the state to retry some of these criminals who ought to have been put to death years and years ago. They care nothing about that. They could care less about crime being committed. That's their job. They love it. They're crime lovers. And they oppose the Word of God. They don't believe the Bible. They're infidels. And it's getting worse all the time. And the devil is taking advantage of all these things today. And of course, he's really having a revival. The devil is having a revival of sin and evil like never before. And it's going to get worse. He knows his time is short and the days are evil. And you haven't seen anything yet because he's controlling the liberal element in the land today. And of course, many of these organizations, like the crime-loving organization, and others that go about trying to get people out of prison that ought to be there, trying to keep people out of the electric chair, should have been put to death a long time ago. The devil is using these people to fill the land with criminals, and the innocent people, the law-abiding citizen, have to suffer and have to foot the bill. Now, someone said, here you have the lust of the flesh, which, of course, they said, in a sense, speaks to the young, about the young, and then the lust of the eyes, the middle age, and then the pride of life, the aged. Yet we do know that Satan tempts all people through these three channels from the cradle to the grave, and you need to realize that. Now, keep in mind, when Satan comes to you and tempting you, he'll come through one of these three channels. Now, you keep that in mind. I'm going to see how he did it in the Bible and what happened to some in the Bible. Now we have only three occasions in the Bible where we have the recorded words of Satan. Have you ever thought about that? Only three occasions in the Bible do you have the recorded words of Satan that he spoke himself. Now he spoke to Eve in Genesis chapter 3, and when he did so, he slandered God. He said, "Yea, hath God said?" Then he said, "Ye shall not surely die." He said, "Ye shall be as gods, and your eyes shall be open." And so you have the devil here talking to Eve in the Garden of Eden, slandering God. Then you go and take a look at Job, the old patriarch of God. And in Job chapter 1, you have the devil slandering man to God. He tells us, and he says here, asks Job the question, "Does Job fear God for naught?" He asked God that, rather. And then he said, "Take what he has, he will call it, curse thee thy face." The devil here is slandering man to God. He's telling God that Job is serving God, what he can get out of it. And he's saying also, "You take what he has and you curse it to your face." And then we find in Matthew chapter 4, we find in respect to Jesus here, he's slandering both God and man. So you see the devil talking in these three different places, and here slandering both God and man. Now notice on whom Satan used all three lanes in the Bible, and see what happened. Did all three yield? Not quite. We'll see from the scriptures, but two did and one did not. He used three lanes on Mother Eve in the Garden of Eden. It says in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 6, "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat." Now Satan came down all three avenues tempting Eve. He tempted her through the lust of the eyes, and the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. All three channels he approached Eve, and she fell, she yielded. We find another person in the Bible that the devil came and tempted through all three channels, and he also yielded. His name was Achan, and this happened in Jericho. In Joshua chapter 7 and verse 21, we find there a man and his family died because they disobeyed God's orders. God told Joshua, he said, "Now there's a curse upon the city of Jericho." I stood there just a few weeks ago, some couple of weeks ago, on this hill where Jericho once stood, and saw some of the old walls and the city upon which the curse came. Now there was a curse upon Jericho. And God said to Joshua, "You tell the people when they go in there to conquer Jericho not to take any of their cursed things, because what they have in that city has a curse on it. And don't take it. Leave it where it is. I put a curse on it." And then we found a man by the name of Achan went in, and the devil took him over, and through the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, he yielded and paralyzed the army of God. In Joshua chapter 7 and verse 21, he said, "When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them, and behold, they're hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it." Now you'll find here that Satan attacked Achan through all three channels, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. You find all three here in Joshua chapter 7 and verse 21. So when the devil came down all three avenues attacking Achan, he yielded. Now what did it cost Achan? It cost Achan his family. They were sent out and burned to death, stoned and burned according to the Bible. That was a penalty they had to pay because Achan allowed the devil to run down three channels and wreck him in that manner. And so you see that taking place. Not only that, but it paralyzed the army of Israel. They went up against Ai, and they could have taken Ai without any problem. And so they went up against Ai, and the people there in Ai came out and overtook the Israelites and killed many of them and caused them to flee. Now, when that happened, Joshua knew something had gone wrong. There shouldn't be any problem in taking Ai because God was with them, but something happened. And Joshua went on his face before God and said, "Lord, what's the trouble? Something is wrong. Our army has fallen back and many of our men been slain. And Lord, what is wrong? Something wrong." God said, "There's sin in the camp. You need to find out where it is. And they began to search out the camp and search out each tent. And they came to Achan's tent. And lo and behold, the lot fell upon Achan. And they asked him about it. And he confessed. He said, yes, when I came into Jericho, I saw a beautiful Babylonian garment. There you have the lust of the eyes. And he said, I saw 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold and 50 shekels. Then I coveted them. You have the lust of the flesh. And then he said, I hid them. There you have the pride of life. He had these hid in his tent, and it paralyzed the army of God. The devil came through all channels to try to stop Israel, to paralyze the army of God and cause his family to die, the entire family being stoned to death. And so these two yielded. But we come to number three, and the devil was not successful there. He was overcome. And you find it recorded in Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4. You find that Jesus up on the mountain of temptation. And by the way, I saw that again on our Holy Land tour seat every year. The mountain of temptation where the devil tempted Jesus. And he was up on this mountain after he was filled with the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit came upon him in the form of a dove after he was baptized by John the Baptist. He went up on this mountain and the devil went up and to tempt him. Now Jesus had been fasting 40 days and nights, and to be sure he was hungry. And the devil said, I must take the advantage of this man now, since he's hungry. I believe I can get him to yield to temptation. The Bible says in Luke chapter 4 and verse 3, the devil approached Jesus and said, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And so there you have the lust of the flesh. Go ahead and command these stones to be turned into bread, and you have something to eat. Now see, you hadn't eaten in 40 days and 40 nights. You've been fasting there on the mountain of temptation. And then he carried him up on the pinnacle of the temple and showed him all the kingdoms round about. Said he showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Verses 9 through 11 of Luke chapter 4. And there you have the lust of the eyes. I want you to look and see all of these great kingdoms out here. They'll be yours if you bow down and worship me. And he said, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. He said, now if you be Jesus, if you be the Son of God, just jump off of this pinnacle, this temple. I saw that also the other day for the pinnacle of the temple where the devil tempted Jesus. And said, if you'll just jump off, and then the angels will catch you before you hit the ground, and you can prove that you're the Son of God. But did Jesus yield? Absolutely not. What did Jesus say to the devil? He said, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, lest any time thou dice thy foot against a stone. Now that's what Satan said to him, because Jesus quoted the scripture of it. And so Jesus knew that he was not to jump off the pinnacle of that temple. He did not. And so what happened here when the devil came with the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, he used all three against the Son of God. But each time that he used one against Jesus, Jesus came back and quoted scripture from the Old Testament. He said, it is written, it is written, it is written. And nowhere did Jesus yield, and no time did Jesus yield to the devil. He overcame the devil. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Now what is meant by that? It is meant that the devil came through all three channels to tempt the Son of God, but he did not yield. Jesus never committed a sin in thought, deed, or action. He never committed a sin from the cradle to the grave. Jesus was perfect the entire time he was upon the earth because he was deity. He was very God, and he could not sin. He used the word of God to defeat the devil. And I want to emphasize that a little further along and let you know how you can overcome Satan. We're living in perilous times and momentous days, and there's a great sin wave on today. You have a lot of racketeers out in the religious world. They deceiving multitudes, and they are sending in thousands and millions of dollars to many of these charlatans and racketeers. Money that could be used for a good cause, and maybe some of them sacrificing money they need to take care of them. God just reached down and pulled the cover off of three of them to let the whole world see what they are. And yet you still have people so deceived until they'll support the same individuals, blinded as they move along, not realizing what they're doing seem like. Anyway, some men have overcome temptation in the Bible. I'm glad everybody didn't yield. Now we see that Eve yielded, and you know what happened as a result of it. We saw Achan yielded, and you see what happened as a result of that. You don't have to yield to the devil. You don't have to yield to temptation. That's a way of escape. Somebody said, well, there's so much sin today and so much worldly pleasure taking place in the world and practice until we just have to kind of go along. No, you don't. You don't have to yield to these temptations. God promised you, you don't have to. You young people don't have to smoke pot. You don't have to take cocaine. You don't have to get on dope. You don't have to smoke cigarettes. You don't have to drink beer, wine, and liquor. You don't have to go to these ungodly, filthy moving picture shows. You don't have to go to these ungodly dance halls and places where they drink and carry on. You don't have to do that. You go there because you want to. You don't have to, but you do that because you want to. The devil leads you on by the lust of the eyes, lust of flesh, and pride of life. Now we find Abraham was tempted greatly whenever he was offered money for what he had done to the glory of God. Now that can be a great temptation. In Genesis chapter 14, verses 21 through 23, and the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the good to thyself. And Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have lift up my eyes, my hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. I will not take a thread nor a shoe latchet or thou art to anything that is thine, lest I should say, I have made Abraham rich. Now, what is that verse of Scripture saying? That verse of Scripture is telling us that this great giant of God, Abraham, when he went out and won the battle, then the kings of Sodom, where God had destroyed with the atomic bomb, Sodom and Gomorrah with fire and brimstone, the kings of Sodom came to Abraham and said, now, we're going to pay you for what you have done. Abraham said, what I did the glory of God. He said, not only that, but he said, I'll not take anything, not even a thread, not even a shoe latchet, will I take, lest you say you have made God's man rich. Let me tell you something. We don't need the devil's outfit to support the work of God. We don't have to have the devil's money to support the work of God. God never intended that this ungodly world, these sinners, support the work of God. God fully intended that his people, true born again believers, children of God, support his work. God's not in that big a tight that we have to have the devil's money from the world out here to support his work. God can turn stones into money if he wanted to. God's not in a tight. Abraham said, I will not take a shoestring from you. Not even a thread. I'm not going to do it. Lest you say you made Abraham rich. And God honored Abraham. And he was a rich man, but the kings of Sodom didn't make him rich. At any time you allow this ungodly world to sway you and buy you over and entice you and try to make you rich with promises of what they have, and you're born again Christian, you are compromising, and it's displeasing to the Lord, and the ends never justify the means. A lot of people say, well, I'll go ahead and accept it, then the ends will justify the means. No, it's never right to do wrong and get a chance to do right. It's always right to do right, and God will bless you. We find another man in the Bible, fine, handsome young man, and his name was Joseph, and he failed to yield to Pharaoh's wife. Pharaoh had a very, very beautiful wife. Those Pharaohs picked the most beautiful women in Egypt for their wives. In Genesis chapter 39, verses 9 and 10, How then can I do this great weakness to sin against God? And it came to pass as she spake to Joseph day by day that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. Now you've read this story many times. Joseph was a very intelligent man. He was God's man, a beautiful type of Jesus. And when Pharaoh would leave to go on a tour or go on a speaking engagement, then Joseph had much time there in the house. God had left everything in his hands. And as soon as Pharaoh would leave, his wife would begin to try to entice Joseph. Joseph, I want you to come and make love to me. Joseph, I want you to come and have sex with me. Joseph, I want you, Joseph. I don't care what the Pharaoh thinks about it, the world thinks about it. I want you. You what I want. I'm going to have you, Joseph. I want you. Did Joseph yield? No, Joseph had a backbone like a saw log. He had some great principles in his system. He loved God. And Joseph said, no, I'm not going to sin against God. I'm not going to be with this woman. And he fled out of the house. And when he started to run out of the house, she grabbed his coat. And he ran out of his coat and left it in the house. And lo and behold, she said, that man's not going to treat me that way. I'm the queen here in this palace. And he'll not get by with this. I know what I'll do. When my husband comes home, I'm going to show him this coat, and I'm going to tell him that this Jew came in here, Joseph came in here, that handsome Jew, and he came in here and he tried to approach me and tried to get me to commit a sin, and I wouldn't do it. And then he fled, and I grabbed his coat and held and kept his coat, and he's gone. And when her husband came home, she told a bald-faced liar. She lied on the man of God, and she told that he came in to try to attack her. And when she screamed, then he ran out and left his coat. And they sent poor Joseph to prison. And he had to stay in prison many years because of this. And so he did not yield to temptation, is what I'm trying to get you to see here. He could have. And as far as men is concerned, probably got by with it for a certain period of time. But he looked higher than man and looked at God and said, I'm not going to sin against God and do this thing against God. Said, Pharaoh trusted me and put me in charge of everything that he had, and I'm not going to treat Pharaoh in this manner. And so Joseph yielded not to Pharaoh's wife, and you can bet your life that she was one of the most beautiful women in the land of Egypt, and she was trying to entice him. Had he not had a backbone like a saw log, he would have yielded. But he had the grace of God in his heart, and he failed to do so. We found another man in the Bible by the name of Moses. Moses was highly educated, and he was in line to be the prime minister in Egypt. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24 and 25, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with people of God than enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. Joseph had the privilege to be the prime minister in Egypt. He said, no, sir, I'm going to step down and go with God's people. I'd rather suffer with the people of God than to be the prime minister of the land of Egypt. I'm thinking about the reward on the other side. I'm going to serve God. Many times you may be offered positions and privileges and opportunities in this life, and you just can't quite accept it because you love God. And if you go ahead and compromise, accept it anyway, you're headed for trouble. Moses refused to do so. We find another in the Bible by the name of Nehemiah. When Nehemiah went back to build the walls of Jerusalem, they tried to scare him away. And he said, shall such a one as I flee? In Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 11, shall such a man as I flee? In Nehemiah chapter 6 and verse 3, I'm doing a great work, so I cannot come down. And Nehemiah refused to listen to that political crowd there in Jerusalem and continued building the wall. And God blessed him and saw him through. He had a backbone. He refused to quit. He said, I'm not a quitter. You know, quitters never win and winners never quit. I'm not a quitter. I'm going to stay put and move on for God. And that he did. There's a lot of backsliders sitting at home today. Maybe some listening right now to the sound of my voice. You're a quitter. You backslid on God. You know you ought to be in God's house and you're not. You're a quitter. Quitters never win. Winners never quit. And you'll be sorry when you come to the judgment seat of Christ. We find another in the Bible. Many men would have yielded to this because this man's wife tried her best to get him to curse God and die. And his name is Job. He rejected his wife's suggestion. In Job chapter 2 and verse 9, then said his wife unto him, does I still retain thy integrity? Curse God and die. You know the story of Job, how he lost everything, even his health. His friends turned on him, lost his children, buried 10 children. And the only one he had left to stand by him was his wife. And she turned on him. And she said, you ought to just go ahead and commit suicide. I'm tired of looking at you and those sores all over your body. You don't have anything left anyway. You lost everything. Why don't you go ahead and just curse God and let him kill you? Job said, you talk like a foolish woman to me. I'm not going to do it. And Job stood true to God, called his wife a fool, stood true to God. In the end, he had twice as much as he had in the beginning. We have another man in the Bible by the name of David. David had a chance to kill Saul. Saul was jealous of David, but Saul was God's anointed. And David came very near Saul there in the camp and sent a man over and cut part of his garment off and brought it back and later called Saul and told him what he done. He said, you see, I could have killed you, Saul, but you are God's anointed, and I'm not going to lay my hand on God's anointed. And he refused to do it. Some of the men said, let us do it. We'll pin him to the ground. We'll stick a sword through him and pin him to the ground. David said, no, you're not going to touch God's anointed. And David stood true to God, would not touch God's anointed. In due time, Saul died with his boots on, and David didn't have to put him to death. God took care of that himself. And then you have the three Hebrew children. You know what happened to them in the book of Daniel? They stood true to God. And we know the Bible says Jesus is tempted all points like unto us, yet without sin. Now, God will not allow us to be tempted above that you're able. Now, you ought to mark this verse of Scripture down. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13. Look at it. There's no temptation taken to you but such as common to man. That's your three-way avenue. Such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with that temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. God promised you in the Bible that he would not let the devil so overpower you but what you can escape if you want to. If you don't want to commit the sin, you don't have to. God will not allow any more put upon you than you can bear. He promised that in the Bible. God will not allow the devil to tempt you but what you can escape if you want to escape. Anybody that yields to the temptation of Satan does it because they want to. They don't have to. They do it because they want to. Now the devil knows his time is short. He knows that, and you need to resist him all you can. You may say, preacher, how can I resist the devil? Brother James tell you what to do. James chapter 4 verse 7, submit yourselves therefore to God. You get that? Submit yourself therefore to God. Submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 22, flee youthful lust. Flee youthful lust. And the Bible says, give not place to the devil. And the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22, abstain from all appearance of evil. If evil is there, you can abstain from it, or you can walk into it. That's left entirely up. You don't go into it blinded. You go into it because you want to. And then cast yourself upon God. Give much time to prayer and the Bible. And pray very much. And yield to God, because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Anytime a Christian sins, he does it because he wants to. He doesn't do it because he can't help himself. He doesn't do it because he's overpowered by the devil. He does it because he wants to, or she wants to. And the Bible is clear on that. There's a little boy one time. He had a little playmate about his equal. And he could take that little old playmate of his and bury his nose in the sand anytime he wanted to and make him holler calf rope. One day he had his nose buried in the sand, and all of a sudden something hit him like a ton of brick. What happened? This little boy had a bigger brother, old big brother. He saw what this boy's doing to his little brother, and he came in like a cyclone and knocked him asunder because he was the big brother of the little boy that was taking the beating. Let me tell you something. You have a big brother, and that elder brother is Jesus Christ. And he that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. And he will help you to overcome any temptation that you want to overcome. You got to want to overcome it. And if you want to, your big brother is bigger than the devil, and he that's in you is greater than he that's in the world, and he can make you an overcomer if you want to be an overcomer. Nobody has any excuse whatsoever for sin they commit. Let's stand to our feet. Father in heaven, I pray that you'll take the message, that you'll use it. May your name be honored. May Jesus be glorified. Lord, we do know only through channels, three avenues can Satan approach us. But you plainly tell us, our Father, that the Spirit of God lift up a standard against him and make us overcomers. Have your way, our Father, in this invitation. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, while Debbie plays for us, listen to me. There may be somebody here you'd like to join this church. You'd like for Northside to be your church home. And if you do, if you want to come and join by statement, by letters of Kenneth Baptist you made, there may be somebody you'd like to get saved. Maybe someone here that'd like to come back into fellowship with God. Maybe someone here you want to come and do business with God. Maybe I didn't mention what you'd be coming about. That's a matter between you and God. And while Debbie is playing for us, do we have one to respond today? Anyone like to come forward today for any reason I've mentioned or for any reason I haven't mentioned? How about it while we wait?